Doing something a little different today. I'm watching a video by a young man who grew up in the 1980s. He's talking about Canadian children TV shows from the 1980s because in the 1970s and 80s and into the 90s, we were forced to watch a lot more Canadian content than US content on Canadian channels. They just made you do it. The TV stations here had no choice. They had to carry Canadian programming, even if they were terrible. And this is, I forget how many TV shows, kids' TV shows that were Canadian content that he thinks sucked, in retrospect. And quite frankly, most of the TV shows I liked as a kid, looking back on them, they sucked. So. Anyways, his first one was Mr. Dress Up. Now, Mr. Dress Up, he's right. Mr. Dress Up was a direct response to Mr. Rogers. He was the Canadian version, but I think it was actually much superior to Mr. Rogers. For one thing, he didn't talk like he was trying not to frighten people or trying to talk to somebody who is incapable of understanding. Mr. Rogers had a very condescending tone to him, if you ask me. That's just the way I see it, anyways. But Mr. Dress Up did a lot more stuff. He had the tickle trunk where he did dress up, thus the name Mr. Dress Up. He did art. He did all kinds of stuff. He was a little bit more diverse than Mr. Rogers, and a lot less condescending sounding, if you ask me. So I'm gonna say Mr. Dress Up was way better, and I still to this day like Mr. Dress Up. I think he stopped in '92. I'm not sure, but yeah. There was a weird thing that a rumor that was spread all around the country that he was arrested for possession of cocaine, but he never was. That's another weird thing about Show number two was today's special. I agree with this. It was a completely vacuous show. Now, I was a little bit older in the 80s when this came out, but I do remember it because there was literally nothing to watch in the mornings on Saturdays when you were a teenager or a young, an older child. There was just nothing to watch in Canada. So we watched this nonsense too. So today's special was a. It was a department store. The woman was what you call a dresser. She set up the department store displays. Now there was a puppet that was supposed to be the security guard who was in on the magic. The magic, of course, being that when you put a hat on the mannequin, he became alive. He became a young man, and they would dance and have pseudo romantic interludes that weren't actually very romantic, but they had romantic overtones, and it was a complete useless filler of a child reading a book and whatnot, and it was empty calories, basically, kind of TV show. It was terrible. Now, he's probably not gonna do the one I want him to do, but we'll see if he does. Okay, number three was the polka dot door. Now, this was for toddlers. Now, any show made for toddlers at all that an adult looks at is gonna be crap. There's no way an adult is going to, unless they're high as. They're not gonna look at things made for toddlers and say that was great. Anyways, yeah, this was another like 1 out of 10 stars. So now Polka Dot Door didn't have puppets because they didn't want to pay for puppeteers. It was that low budget. They just had stuffed animals or stuffed toys. And then there was the third character. There was a male character and a female character, and then there was that were pretending to play with the children. Then there was the third character that would show up eventually, called the Pokeroo, which was a magic animal character thing, and it was literally, even then, looking at it, I never really watched the show, but I saw it a couple of times when I was at a friend's house, because he had a younger sister, and she watched this damn thing, and the Pokeroo was super ultra annoying. If you've seen Barney the Purple Dinosaur, think of Barney the Purple Dinosaur, but being extremely brain damaged. That's the Pokeroo. Fred Penner. Now, he said it wrong. He just said Fred Penner. It's Fred Penner's Place, if I remember correctly. I'm not actually looking this crap up. Anyways, Fred Penner was a children's singer entertainer who sang songs that he wrote, songs that were in the public domain, and goofy, childish covers of pop songs from the 1960s. Oh my God. Yeah, Fred Penner was filler, if you ask me. Fred Penner, I would actually give more stars than the Pokeroo crap. That's for damn sure. Out of 10, I'm gonna have to give Fred Penner a 3. Mr. Dresser, by the way, I would have given a 5. He's a pass. Yeah, but Fred Penner is still going today, and he looks like Red Green today. If you see Fred Penner, he literally looks like Red Green. I mean, extremely like Red Green. So, yeah. But yeah, he gave his entire life to entertaining children, so thumbs up. I hate to do this. I do. I do. The Friendly Giant was the last one he talked about. Now, the Friendly Giant is iconized in Canada. There are literally millions of people who have extremely fond memories of this crap show. It was considered the best children's TV show ever produced in Canada by millions of people, literally, literally. There are people that have Friendly Giant merchandise that have made castles, the castle, the Friendly Giant castle, and all that stuff. And I actually know a couple of people that have done stuff like this, made their Friendly Giant dioramas and that they have in their den. And these are adults, in their 50s, Anyways, Friendly Giant went for 30 years, give or take. Now, this was completely and utterly vacuous. There was almost no entertainment to this at all. That they did have the music room where they went and did a brief musical number, where the Friendly Giant would play the flute, and the rooster would play the rooster in a bag, by the way. I can't remember his name, I'm sorry. Then there was Jerome the Giraffe, Rusty the Rooster, and Jerome the Giraffe, who you saw through the window. Rusty was in a bag. Basically, devices so you can see the puppeteer's arms. Anyways, Rusty would play the harp, and Jerome would just sort of be there. But yeah, most of the time they just talked about stuff, and it was completely empty calories, just like a lot of the TV shows back then. Well, and like a lot of kids' TV shows today, they're empty calories. But yeah, the Friendly Giant has been put on a pedestal, but it is really a terrible show. There is almost no entertainment value in this at all, except for the musical interlude. The rest of it, they're literally talking about things like dog shed hair, things like that, right? And it's not even in a very educational light. It's like random coffee house banter, but for toddlers, you know what I mean? It was one of the, now the one I wanted him to do went all the way into the 90s on CBC, I do believe. Maybe it was CTV, I'm not sure. Don't quote me. But it was called The Forest Rangers. You can find this on YouTube. You can find all of these on YouTube, actually. Yeah, the Forest Rangers. Now they had a fort, the log fort, right, that they had built. And basically, the father, the father figure was a Mountie or a forest ranger, or was a forest ranger, that is. And now the strong male lead, the person who has the moral role, was a First Nations person, a Canadian native fellow, who taught them how to do bushcraft and stuff like this. This was a whole new level of it was so much better than the other stuff, but it was still, compared to today's content for children's entertainment, it was just like, what the hell was that? But yeah, it was way better than Mr. Rogers or Fred Penner or Poker Bloody Roo or the Friendly Giant. Basically, they taught you a lot of stuff like bushcraft and stuff. They didn't teach you in depth, but they got you interested into it. And it was the only kids show that I've ever seen that did that. I'm sure there's probably some American equivalent of this out there, but I have never seen it. If there is, tell me about it. I'll look it up. Anyways, yeah, so they talked about that. There was one episode where it was the one boy's birthday, and they gave him a buck knife. Now this is a hunting knife. It's a substantial knife, basically, and they're very, very sharp. They're made for skinning animals, basically. And gutting and skinning animals. A lot of people nowadays would be like, oh my God. Because you're giving me a child a knife, a child. But yeah, back then, that was not uncommon in the 1970s, 60s, and 70s to give a child a hunting knife. It really was not. I had one when I was a kid, a younger kid. And yeah, anyways. I just now I have to touch on something that was not a children's entertainment show per se. It was a sci-fi. I loved this damn show when I was a kid. I mean it. I loved it. It was called The Star Lost. Star Lost is one word. When you look it up, and you can see it on YouTube, it's horrific. This is literally, one of the worst shows ever made. It is on par with the first season of Doctor Who, for really bad effects. The robots, I remember talking about this because I have really fond memories until I looked it up of watching this in the 1970s, and I was glued to the TV, and it was like the best thing ever. It was the Canadian Star Trek. Oh, no, God, it didn't even compare. Anyways, yeah, I loved it. I just loved it. I can't stress enough how much I enjoyed this show. But then I watched it. I watched all of it on YouTube. I couldn't stop. It was like watching a train wreck. You know, you can't look away. My friend at coffee was telling me, dude, the robots were made out of cardboard boxes with dryer ducts for arms. And I'm like, no, they were real robot things. And no, they were cardboard boxes with dryer ducts for arms and legs. And it was just terrible content. The writing was atrocious. The storyline was flawed, to say the least. These two Amish people, literally Amish people, escaped from their domes because society is on the ark. The ark is heading toward another planet because the Earth is dead. It's going to be multi-generations till it gets there. Now, each culture is in their own dome, separated from each other, so there's no conflict. Now, you can't get out of your dome normally, but these armies people managed to get out of their dome. And then they use videotapes to learn how to fix the nuclear reactor and the star drive. It's just terrible. Now the crew's dead, but the family of the crew is still there, and you know, never know what happened to them. You never know why the crew is dead and why their family didn't look at the computer videotape machine thing and learn stuff, because they're all this is generations after the disaster, by the way. They're all completely uneducated and living in shambles and all that stuff. And it's like, what the hell? It just does not make sense. And it is just bad. I mean, 1 star out of 10 bad. Super sucked. Yep, but I had such fond memories. But the Canadian show of all time, from the 1980s and 90s, had to be Forever Night. I love this show. Today, I still love this show. Now, he's a vampire that's a cop. That's right, a vampire that is a cop. It's a weird premise, but it worked. And he went to a bar that was down the stairs from an alley called the Raven. Now, I have been to the actual bar that they filmed this in. It was called the something Vampire something Club. Anyways, but yeah, it when I got there, anyways, so this was way after the show. But yeah, it was the same bar, or it was made to look like the bar, one or the other. But yeah. Anyways, those are my fond memories from the 70s, 80s, and 90s of Canadian TV content. You betcha. Oh my God. Oh my God. No, what was his name? Tommy Hunter. We watched Tommy Hunter for years. Tommy Hunter was a country music entertainer, and he would do country music songs. We watched the Tommy Hunter Hour for years, as a family. Stompin' Tom Connors, you can look him up. He had a brief appearance on TV. I think he went one season, where he did his music and he was stomping on his board. That's why they call him Stompin' Tom. He would stomp his foot, for a musical beat, a drum beat type thing. He would stomp his foot. So yeah, that was the content that I grew up with.